Well, I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. Failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. Then you called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness to with me. Needed rescue, my sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven.
Continue to sing your praise, Lord.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah.
sing a little louder.
Let's sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Here comes the fight for me.
Hey! Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Here comes the fight for me.
Sing a little louder.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Walking on the water, even when I could not see. In the middle of it all, when I thought you were a thousand miles away, not for a moment did you forsake me, not for a moment did you forsake.
Good. I've searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise, the treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along and put me back together. Is now satisfied here in your love. 'Cause there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. sing that chorus again. Let's just make that our prayer to end our time of worship here.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Sing it again, raise your voice.
There's nothing.
We've tasted and we've seen just how good your love is. And we find ourselves sometimes a little aimless. Your grace and your mercy draws back. God, there is nothing, nothing like you. You alone are worthy and deserving of our praise. Thank you for your love and your grace. And sacrifice the blood of Jesus on the cross. And life everlasting. We love you and we worship you and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hey, I want to thank you for joining us this weekend for our online services here at New Life. And this is just one more opportunity for us to, again, lean in for all that God has for us. You know, this time, and I know we say this over and over, but it's been so crazy. Here we are participating in church online, but there's something powerful about this moment that goes beyond whether it's on our phone or on our TV or whether we're gathered live, that we are connecting with the God of the universe. So I'm glad you've come to join us and be part of that this weekend. So a couple things I want you to do as we get going. One, I want you to get your phones out. And I know what you're saying. You're going, I know what to do with that, Dave. You say it every single week. Well, I have something different for you. As we head into this Thanksgiving week, what I want you to do is I want you to think of one person, maybe two, but one person, and just text them right now, I'm thankful for you. That's it. You may want to even say a little bit more about why you're thankful, but you don't have to. Just, I'm thankful for you. It's a way of reaching outside of where we are right now in our four walls to impact somebody else. Also, if you need prayer, we'd love for you to text the word prayers to 70500. You'll see that on the screen below here. And we take those every week, immediately send those to our team, and we're praying for the things that concern you. Also, if you want to stay kind of up to date on what's happening, text the word update to 70500, and you can kind of keep in touch with us and know what's coming up and happening. Well, right now, this is this moment where we pause in our live service, but also in our online service, to continue in worship, but through generosity and giving. And you know, God has been so good to us. He provides so much. And as we head into this Thanksgiving week, I think we maybe even sense that more than any other time, at least our awareness is of how much God does. And we just want to say thank you. And so our giving back to him is a way of responding to his provision, his kindness, his goodness, his grace towards us, and saying, I'm all yours, God. All I have, all I am, I put it in your hands. And the Bible says in the book of Malachi that when we respond back in obedience to God, that we don't hold it and rob from him, but instead we give back to him, that it says that he opens up the windows of heaven to pour out blessing. And I hope you can experience that as you give back to God. There's a lot of ways you can do that through our app. You can do it online. You can mail it in. You'll see the information below. But I hope you'll take this opportunity to begin a new habit of saying, God, I'm going to trust you with everything, including the resources that you've given me. Last, before we jump into our message, I just want to remind you of the three lanes that we have here at New Life. We've used this metaphor of kind of like a freeway. Multiple lanes all going in the same direction. And that's how we're going to connect during this season of our culture and of life. And the first lane is new life at home. And some of you are doing that right now. Maybe you have a cup of coffee. Maybe you're sitting there with your phone, watching on the TV, whatever it might be, but you're participating. You're the church. You're part of our new life family, but you're doing that at home right now. And that's a place God has for you to grow in. The second lane is new life with friends, and some of you have gathered together with a small group of people, those who you're connected with and you're close to, and you're watching a service together. You're going through our questions that we have, life group questions online, which, by the way, online there's all kinds of resources for kids and students and groups and discussion, going a little bit deeper, so make sure you check those out. Some of you are doing that right now at home, and that is a great place to be with friends growing in Christ together. And the third lane is our New Life Live, and that is our weekend gathering. Right now it's Sunday mornings at 9 and 10:30, and if you're comfortable doing that, we'd love to have you. We're still in the mode of being safe and healthy and prepared for every single person who walks through our doors. And so as you're inside, we have masks and we're social distancing, but it's a chance for us to be together. And so, love to invite you to that as well. Well, I want you to take your note-taking sheet, and hopefully you got that on a resource online. Take your Bible, whether that's digital or paper, and I want you to turn to the book of Psalms chapter 103. So how do you get to Psalms? Is you take your Bible and you split it right down the middle, and you will probably be in the book of Psalms. And this week, as we head into Thanksgiving, we're talking about having an attitude of gratefulness. Some people say an attitude of gratitude, but it's simply that place of being thankful. And I know, it's Thanksgiving time, and it's like, well, of course we're gonna talk about it during this time. But the truth is this heart of thankfulness and gratitude is not a November experience, but it should be our moment by moment, step by step, trustful walk with God, that we're thankful and grateful for all that He has given. Now, I know this can tend to be an uncomfortable topic because sometimes it reveals our own ungratefulness or our own sense of expectation or our own sometimes place of entitlement that I deserve those things. And if we're not careful, it's easy to forget where all of our blessings come from. So back earlier this year, I had been listening to something, and I came across this statistic, and this was not a Christian or a religious or a faith-based statistic. It was just this statistic that the happiest people every single day thought of 7 things that they were grateful for. And so I thought, I wonder if I can do that every single day. And so I took a little post-it note, literally put it in the dash of my car. I kind of put it so I could hide the speedometer, so I really didn't know how fast I was going. No, I didn't do that. I just had it on the dash, and it said, what 7 things am I grateful for today? So every day when I'd get into my truck and I'd turn it on, I just said, what am I grateful for today? And at first it was easy. I'm thankful for my wife and for my kids. And if I name them individually, I've got 4 of them right there. And then a grandson, I've got another one. But I tried to day by day get a little more creative. And what I sensed in that was God even just saying, go deeper, go deeper. What are you grateful for? What is it today you can say, God, I thank you for this? And so I thought of more things, and day by day it got to be more challenging. And of course, some days I would have duplicates. I'm grateful for my wife every day and grateful for my kids every day. But if I really had to think and process more, it's what are those deeper things that often go unspoken or sometimes even unnoticed or unthought of? And am I grateful for those? Oh, what about you? What are you grateful for? Again, not just because it's Thanksgiving, but what would it look like for you to go deeper in gratitude? So we're going to be looking today at Psalm 103. And King David wrote this psalm, and it's one of my favorite psalms. But as I was reading through it, I thought, I wonder where he was when he wrote this. And there's a lot of, oh, my heart, I'll praise the Lord. It was just this kind of recognizing all these good things that God does. And just, I don't know if you ever just kind of go there in your imagination to go, I wonder where he was when he started to just kind of put paper to, or pen to paper, or quill to parchment or, you know, whatever he had. But would it have been maybe an early morning? Maybe he was the only one up and he walked out and he was looking out over Jerusalem or maybe over a field. Maybe he was out somewhere in the country. Or maybe he was just sitting back and he was watching his kids and his grandkids play or interact or laugh or have fun. I wonder if it came out of a relational kind of moment. Or maybe he was at a place that was just beautiful. Maybe he was sitting by a lake. Maybe he'd gone on a journey or a hike and he was sitting there. Or maybe he was at a place where some historical, great, mighty event that had happened and he was just moved to this place of gratitude. I don't know. None of us can know. But I just imagine, what would that look like for him to write that down? And in these first five verses, David begins to talk about God's relationship to him. And in the New Living, he says this in the very first verse, Psalm 103. He says, "Praise the Lord. I tell myself with my whole heart, I will praise his holy name." Now, I don't know if you catch this. He's actually talking to himself. He's talking, and we'll see later, to his own heart and his own soul. And he's saying, don't forget this. Don't forget this moment of praise. And then he says, "Let all that I am praise the Lord." Let all that I am with my whole heart praise him. And then he goes on and he adds this, "May I never forget the good things that he does for me." And if you skip down a little bit, and we're going to come in back and fill in a little bit of these gaps, but the beginning of verse 19 through the end of the chapter, David turns to the universe and it's the Lord of the heavens and he sees all this grand creation around him. It's like he can't stop being grateful. It's like he can't stop this thankfulness from rolling out of him as he just opens his eyes and he looks around. And I think about us today, and we've been given nearly every opportunity, every comfort, every freedom. And some would argue with that, but the truth is these are unprecedented times. We sometimes forget to thank God and to praise him because we're so conditioned to all the things that we have. And I think it says something about our soul when we somehow lose the ability to be grateful. I think it's almost like that light on your dashboard of your car. It's an indicator that something's amiss, that something's not operating correctly, something's out of sync. And the truth is that there ends up being an unhealthiness, almost like a sickness deep down in our souls when we are no longer grateful and thankful. But what do you say of a person who forgets good things that are done for them by someone else? What are you if someone, you know, has kind of given you everything and then you just forget about them? You just move on. What's the word we use for that? Well, we use the word ungrateful. I'm sure you've had a circumstance where you have done something kind of out of the goodness of your heart. That's the phrase we use. We've done something to be nice to someone, to be kind to someone. Maybe you went into their yard and raked their leaves, or maybe you baked some cookies, or you fixed something up. You didn't have to. No one asked you. It wasn't required of you by any means, but you simply took that step to be kind. And then they didn't even notice. There was no, "Hey, thanks for doing that." And some of us, if parents would say, "Those kids today, right? I mean, they're so ungrateful." I'm not talking about your kids. I'm talking about us. About us, our own hearts. There's this passage in 2 Timothy chapter 3. And when I was thinking about how we sometimes forget the benefits of God, we forget the good things that he has done. And I was wondering, is this something we do even today? And we do. I do. I'm sure you do at times. And 2 Timothy chapter 3 is really this commentary on not just the early church or the early community in the first century, but it's really a commentary on us in the 21st century. The Apostle Paul, who writes this letter, gives us 19 serious characteristics about our culture. And he says, in those last days, there will be things that are hard to handle. And he talks about terrible things, talks about evil things. He talks about all these different scenarios that, unfortunately, we continue to see today. He talks about people who will be lovers of self, and they will be lovers of money and material things. Then he says they'll be boastful and arrogant. They'll be unholy, unforgiving, and brutal. They'll be disobedient to parents. And then early in this list is this word, they'll be ungrateful. Now, doesn't that seem like a mismatch? When you think of evil and unholy things, you think of, you know, lovers of selves and money and all these different things that kind of lend itself towards that. And then here's this one, just ungrateful. One author wrote this: the strange characteristic of ingratitude is that it's the most hurting of all the sins because it's the blindest of all sins. Well, I don't know about you, but I don't want to be blind and ungrateful. I want to live in a place of thankfulness and gratitude. Not so that I can say, look how thankful I am, or look how grateful I am. That's not it at all, because that ties into my own humility. But the truth is, I want those things to be true in my life because I want my soul to come alive to all that God has done in me and all that he has been at work in around me. So I want to challenge you, as you head into this Thanksgiving week, to immerse yourself in gratitude. Maybe you can put a little sticky note in your card and just say, what 7 things am I grateful for today? Just try it for 1 week. For 1 week, 7 days. That means you're gonna have to come up with 49 things to say, this is what I'm thankful for. But I think it'll challenge you to think deeper, to lean in deeper, and to say, wow, I hadn't even really considered that that's what God has done for me. So we're going to jump in here to Psalm 103 again, and we're going to back up to the beginning of that chapter again. And I want to give you just several things to write down, things that we can thank God for that come right from Psalm 103. The first is this: I thank God for forgiveness, for forgiveness. Look at verse 3 in Psalm 103. It says, he forgives all my sins. Have you ever really stopped to think about that? You see, the power of this challenge is that it makes us recognize that there was sin to forgive in the first place. Sometimes we want to just brush right past that, but we were lost, every single one of us. We see that in the Bible, that all of us have this place where we don't measure up to God's level of perfection. All of us are in that place of sin. Have you ever really thought and considered what your life would be like if you went to confess a sin to God and God came back and said, you've gone too far, no more forgiveness? It's easy to forget the forgiving heart of God. Look at verse 10 in Psalm 103. It says, he does not punish us for all our sins. He does not deal harshly with us as we deserve. I don't know about you, but I thank God for that. Have you ever even considered that, hey, what I'm facing is unfair? That why am I going through this? We can sometimes be angry at God, and guess what? God can handle our frustration. He can handle our anger. If anyone showed us that, it was King David in the Psalms, where he would get frustrated at so many things. And I think all of us have faced situations where we would say, this isn't right. But have you ever thought this? What if I really got what I deserved? Not what am I not getting? It's what if I actually got what I deserved? That's an even scarier thought. And David kind of brings us around to recognizing that God has forgiven me. He doesn't deal harshly with me as I deserve. He doesn't give me the full brunt of my sin, but instead he makes a way through this. Verse 12 and said, says, he has removed our sins from us as far as the east is from the west. Now, I don't know if you're aware of that, but that's a long way. It's an infinite distance that he has removed our sins from us. Forgiveness is first in order as you walk in gratitude. You think of the good, forgiving hand of God. I want you to go back for just a moment, and I want you to think back just this past week and think what life would be like if God had not forgiven you. Go back over the past month. If it helps, let your mind play back the record of this whole 2020 year that's been so crazy. Think of all that has gone sideways in that year. Think of the choices that you've made. Think of the temptations that have got its hook in you. And think about this. He's forgiven all your sin. Write this down for number two. Thank God for healing. Look at the second part of that third verse in Psalm 103. He says, and heals all my diseases. Now, thanking God for healing, recognizing that something in me needs his touch. There's a part in me that's broken and wounded and hurting. And so I need this healing to go on. Were you sick this past year? Chances are, some of us watching this right now, we're very sick this year. I know some of you have battled the coronavirus and you have struggled through that. But what's impressive to me in this psalm is that David doesn't say he diagnoses all your diseases. See, our doctors and medical team can do that. And I'm so grateful for them and for the expertise and the training that they bring to the table. There are some specialists who do a great job at putting their finger on whatever the issue is and saying, that's the cause. Here's the health issue. But God's the one who heals us. He's the one who restores us. But this isn't just talking about diseases of the body. It's not just talking about the physical and sickness and cancer and all the different things that we battle with. Now, remember back at verse one, who's David talking to in this psalm? His whole heart, his soul. He's talking to the inner part of himself. And he's saying, God has healed the diseases, the sickness of my soul. The inner wounds and the inner disease of hatred and pride and racism and revenge and stubbornness and bitterness and ego. He's healing me. That's why gratitude is such an incredible indicator of the state of our soul. And when we find ourselves ungrateful and unthankful, there's something that's polluting us. Remember the healing that God has done in your life and in mine over this past year. I'll tell you, he has done so many things in me, a number of inside jobs that only Jesus and I know about. And this year, this Thanksgiving, is my opportunity to turn that blessing, to turn his work into praise, into thankfulness. Write this down for number three. Thank God for his rescue. Thank God for his rescue. Look at verse four. He says, he ransoms me from death. Now, some versions say he has rescued me from the pit. And this literally means to be in ruin, to be in destruction or corruption, that he saves my life from the pit. Last week in the message, we were reading that passage and we talked, and it talked about, you know, that he's rescued me from the pit. And I asked you, how many of you have been in the pit? And I don't know what you did online, but here in our live service, there were so many people that raised their hand. It's like, yeah, I've been in the pit. Some are still thinking, I'm still in the pit, that place where it's just like, I can't rescue myself. I can't somehow figure my way out of that. It's not about being strong enough or smart enough or connected enough. I'm in this place where I need a rescuer. And this reference is literally the moment of salvation. Remember when you were lost? The Bible says you were in the pit, that I was in the pit. One of the prophets writes that we are never to forget the pit from which we have been dug or which we've been rescued. What a perfect picture of where we are. But here's the current reference. When we climb back into the pit of old habits and sin, something has gone out of alignment. We're torn on the inside because a part of us doesn't want to do those things again, doesn't want to travel down that road. But a part of us desires to go back in. The Apostle Paul made this so clear. He said, the things that I don't want to do, and I find myself doing them. And the things I know I should do, I find myself kind of running away from. I don't want to do them. That's the battle. It's the tension that we're in. But David reminds us that we thank God because he rescues us from that again and again and again. Write this down for number four. Thank God for his love and his mercy. His love and his mercy. Look at the end of verse four. It says, and surrounds me. He surrounds me with love and tender mercies. Now this passage kind of makes a statement, and then you'll see David come back to it several other times. So look at verse eight. He says, the Lord is compassionate and merciful, slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love. Then jump down to verse 13. He's just skipping through here. The Lord is like a father to his children. Here are these phrases, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. You know what's so incredible about grace? I almost said, you know what's so amazing about grace? We know that song. But here's what's so incredible. God has brought us into his family without a probation period. You ever started a new job and they'll say, well, you're on a 60-day probation period or a 30-day, or, you know, jobs have different kind of requirements for them. But what is a probation period? It's saying you're hired here, but this is kind of you're kind of seeing if this is a good fit for you, and we're kind of looking to see, can you really do this job? Can you fit in? Can you measure up? Can you do what's required of you? And we understand those kinds of probation periods. But here's what's amazing. When you come into God's family, there's no probation period where you have to somehow prove yourself. Isn't that crazy? Like, you don't have to get yourself good enough. You don't have to somehow perform to an acceptable level. I mean, think about what if God had placed you on probation back then. I mean, if you're like me, you're probably grateful that he didn't. But what if he had? That you have to somehow work hard enough, that you're going to have to prove yourself. You're going to be on trial for a while, and then we'll see, can you come in a little further? Can you really be part of the family? But none of that is true. When you come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you become a member of his family, not 30 days from now, not 60 days from now, but right now. No proving. And the Bible says he crowns you, bestows upon you love and compassion. And I'll tell you what, if you forget everything else in this message, you just go on your way. Don't forget this, that his love and his compassion, his mercy crown our lives. They are for you and for me. Write this down for the last one. Thank God for his good gifts. Look at Psalm 103, verse 5. David said, he fills my life with good things, and my youth is renewed like the eagles. Now, I'll be honest and tell you, when I was younger, that verse didn't do a whole lot for me. But as I get older, to think that my youth is renewed like the eagles. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean that I don't get as sore as I used to, or doing things, I don't get a little more tired? No, it's not about that. Again, remember who he's speaking to. Remember the context of this. He's thinking about his heart and his soul, and there's this renewal that happens in us in gratefulness, in thankfulness, in praise, recognizing that this is the Father who gives us good things, that he satisfies our spirit with his goodness. And the idea here is that he provides what is enjoyable and what is satisfying deeply, so that our strength, our passion is renewed like the eagles. Like, we can mount up again. There's another passage. We mount up on the wings of eagles. There's this new thing that God does as he refreshes and restores us. And Jesus keeps us vital and real. And all those things that we sometimes have a hard time even describing, it's him. He's the giver of good gifts. So let me just ask you this, and we're almost done, but do you know someone who gives good gifts? I mean, you know that person, there may be someone in your family, and they always just seem to just give really good gifts, like perfect. And we're not talking about spending a lot of money or even sometimes super extravagant or fancy or anything like that. But their gifts are just like right on. So my wife is a very thoughtful, good gift giver. And I can think of two gifts that she's given me that, again, weren't fancy or expensive, but they were touching to me. One is about a year ago, she gave me a frame with a picture of myself and my grandson. And I have that on a desk in our office at home. And seeing that picture, it was just like, I love that kid. And to see me in this picture with him, it meant a lot to me. And then she also gave me another framed, it was actually a painting, and it's a page out of an old dictionary. And on it is this painting of a sparrow. And you would maybe look at it and go, oh, that's kind of cool, kind of different and unique, and just think, oh, okay, well, that's it. But to me, it has special meaning. Because a couple years ago when I was on my sabbatical, there was a moment, and I've told this story before, when I had been going through that passage where Jesus says that you're worth more than sparrows, you know, that he knows even when a sparrow falls to the ground, and he knows the worth of just the smallest bird, and how much more does he care about me and know me. And I was walking along after thinking about that. I just read that in the Bible, and I was out by the coast, and I walked down this trail, and right on the fence next to the trail were these two sparrows. And it was almost like God was winking at me, going, see, I know, you just read that, and I just want you to know how loved you are. And it was a moment just for me and God, but it was special. And I'd shared that story with my wife, and so she came across this painting. She was at an event, and she saw it there, and so she bought it for me. So it doesn't have meaning for anyone else, but for me, man, it just speaks something. And if my wife can give gifts that good, imagine God, the perfect giver of good gifts. He knows exactly what you need, and he doesn't hold back. In fact, the Bible says that he's lavish. He's extravagant in his generosity. 1 John 3 says this, see what great love the Father has lavished on us. Again, over the top, extravagant, that we should be called children of God. So how do you count your blessings? What blessing that you're experiencing in your life right now can you turn into praise? Not just as a receiver that I'm getting these things from God, but I can express back to him. What can you be grateful for? Not just on Thanksgiving, but moment by moment. Psalm 84 says this, for the Lord God is our sun and our shield. He gives us grace and glory. The Lord will withhold no good thing from those who do what is right. Maybe this week is maybe just the switch that flips for gratitude in your life, in my life, not just for Thanksgiving, but day by day. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much that you are the one who forgives, and you are the one who rescues, and you are the one who loves us. You're the one who gives us mercy and compassion. You're the one who gives good gifts. And Lord, we just need to ask your forgiveness, which we know you freely give, to just say, we're sorry, God, that we don't express our gratitude and our praise and our thankfulness as often as we should. That rather than those things kind of bubbling up within us as we see the blessings that you pour into our lives, we sometimes walk in this place of entitlement and ego and all those things. But Lord, today I pray that we would be humbled to just simply say, thank you. Thank you, God, for all that you do, for all that you've done, for all that you continue to accomplish in each one of us. We thank you and we honor you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So this week, walk in gratitude, walk in thankfulness, and see what God will do. As we're closing out, I want to just read you I came across this benediction, and I think it's so perfect for Thanksgiving. And I don't want to just proclaim this over us as we end this service. May the God who always welcomes us home reveal to you the countless reasons we have to be thankful to him. During this week of Thanksgiving, may the blessings you take time to reflect on be reminders that God's goodness is never in short supply. May your soul find its satisfaction in our Heavenly Father, for all good things find their source in him. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you peace. Have a great Thanksgiving.